Hello everybody and welcome to lesson 5 of Traffic Dynamics and Simulation Master's course. In this lesson we will start with part 2, that means traffic flow models. In this lesson we will give an overview over the different model classes and also introduce the general aspects of macroscopic modeling. For this, after giving the overview, we will define macroscopic quantities, first for lane basic traffic, but also for directed lane free two-dimensional traffic flow. Then we will derive and give some basic relations, such as the basic traffic stream relations, such as the hydrodynamic relation. Then also the continuity equations for different configurations. And finally, we will also change the point of view and switch from the general Eulerian view, that means from a fixed viewpoint, an outside observer, into the Lagrangian view, that means an observer inside a vehicle. Let's give a short model overview. First, and that will be a topic of this and the following two lessons, are macroscopic models. In macroscopic models, we have not the smallest useful units that obviously are drivers with their vehicles and pedestrians or cyclists or whatever moves on the roads, but we aggregate this to so-called macroscopic quantities, which are some sort of local averages, for example, the density, the number of vehicles per meter or per square meter, the local speed, that's just the local average, then also local flow, that means number of vehicles per seconds, and derive equations for these macroscopic quantities. More intuitively, more complicated to simulate and calculate are the microscopic models. There, obviously, we have just the smallest sensible units that are obviously the driver vehicle units, are the dynamic parts and are modeled, for example, such as Newtonian particles. That means we have forces, which are, of course, social forces, not physical forces. So in order that the drivers avoid crashes and so on. Then we have a category which is semantically different from this one, but it's more a mathematical realization. These are cellular automaton. That means here we have no continuous space and time, but we have discrete time. Typical time step is 1 second, and we have also discrete space in form of cells. And in each cells, if it's a microscopic model, it can be occupied by or not occupied by a vehicle or not but there are also cellular automata for macroscopic models. So this is more a mathematical realization. And finally, this is also sort of microscopic pedestrian model. It's a pedestrian model where, in contrast to all this above, we do not have directed traffic, but undirected traffic, which is fully two-dimensional. So let's now come to the basic macroscopic quantities for lane-based traffic. That means, going back, we consider now in the rest of the lesson the macroscopic model, mostly of car traffic, but also a macroscopic version of a pedestrian model. So let's just start with the simplest configuration. It's just a multi-lane straight road, straight homogeneous road. We denote the lane index with L. Depending on the convention, you can number it from right to left or from left to right. You have only to watch that your numbering is consistent, but otherwise you are free to do how you like. And in each lane, we have macroscopic quantities density, vehicles per meter, flow, vehicles per second, and speed, meter per second. Often, however, we want to aggregate further and calculate some directional road quantities. That means sort of averaging or aggregating or summing up over the different lanes. This leads us to total quantities. That's just the sum of the lane based quantities, and also we will have effective or average quantities. That means just the row without a lane index, it's just the lane average density, flow, and speed. However, obviously, it's not sensible to calculate, for example, the total speed, because it's pretty nonsense just to sum the speeds of the three lanes. In fact, we have two categories of variables: extensive and intensive variables. The extensive variables, that's like in thermodynamics and physics, they increase with the particle number. Here, of course, the vehicle number, also the pedestrian number. That's obviously the density and the flow, because by definition, density is the number of vehicles per distance, and flow the number of vehicles per time. Obviously, they increase with the vehicle numbers. And for these extensive quantities, we can just add the lane quantities to get the total quantity, just the sum of, for example, the density. The same is for the flow. And for the effective quantities, for the whole directed mode, we have just a simple plain lane arithmetic average to get the density average, and also likewise for the flow. This is different for intensive quantities. Intensive quantities are typical ratios of extensive quantities. For example, the speed, which is the ratio of the flow divided by the density. So there's no total quantity. You can, of course, calculate the total quantity. For example, if we have three lanes, on each lane, the speed is 100 km per hour, then the total speed would be 300 km per hour. Does not make sense at all. What makes sense indeed is effective quantities. And how do we, you could say a simple arithmetic average is enough, such as in the extensive quantities. But for example, think that we have three lane traffic, and there's a simple fast moving car on the middle lane, and no car on the left lane, and all the remaining cars, slow cars, on the right lane. Then the arithmetic average would just give, of course, first the left lane would be undefined because there's no speed, but also for the two other lines, we would just count the single fast car as much as the many low speed cars on the right hand lane. So we need to do something more elaborate. And also, we want to make sure that the hydrodynamic relation, flow is density times speed, also applies for these effective quantities. And in fact, we will use just this condition to calculate the arithmetic, calculate the effective quantities. In fact, as I will show now, there are two ways of doing it. Let's first calculate the first way. And also, let's because the average and total extensive quantities only differ by the lane number L, we obviously, if we do the ratio for the total of effective extensive quantities will give the same. So we will just do it for the total quantities. Let's do it the first way. First, we just by definition, that's what we require. The speed is the total flow divided by the total densities. Now we keep the denominator, but apply the definition of the extensive quantity flow to the numerator. So it's just the sum of the individual flows, QL, and QL, because the hydrodynamic relation applies for each lane separately, we have just rho times speed. So in effect, we get a weighted average, a weighted arithmetic average. The effective speed is just the weighted arithmetic lane speed, and the weighting is the partial density. That means the density on lane L divided by the total density. That sounds pretty simple and straightforward. However, if we have loop detectors, county detectors, we have learned that the density is very error prone and has systematic bias. So we want also a speed measure which is not based on densities, but flows, because flows are easily and bias-free calculated by loop detectors, which are also called counting detectors. So obviously, then flow is the quantity to include. Let's just try it by checking what the inverse speed will look like. Of course, we know what the result is, so that's why we start with the inverse speed. So you do not need to learn that. It's just that the presentation is more straightforward. Of course, first by the hydrodynamic definition, the requirement is just the density divided by the flow. Again, we now apply the definition of extensive quantities, total quantities to the numerator. So it's just the sum of the lane densities divided by the flow. And now we again apply the hydrodynamic relation for the lane-based quantities by replacing the density by flow divided by speed. And we arrive again at arithmetic weighted average. However, it's not for the speeds, but for the inverse speeds. And the weighting in this time is with a partial flow instead of a partial density. And by definition, the harmonic average is the arithmetic average of the inverse quantity. So if we and the inverse quantity has the arithmetic average, it's just weighted arithmetic average. So the inverse, again, then we get for the speed, the harmonic average. So this is a nice result. Just by making the hydrodynamic relation consistent also for the averaged quantities, we could calculate it in two ways. If we have available the partial densities, as for aerial photographs, we can just use the arithmetic average with the weighting of the partial densities. If we have counting detectors, then we calculate the harmonic average, and the weighting is then the partial flows. Unfortunately, in reality, we nearly always only have available the arithmetic speed averages, but it could be better if the harmonic were available. Traffic flow is not always on lane-based roads, but there's also fully two-dimensional traffic and also a very mixed traffic. That's, for example, image from India, where we have normal cars, but much more three-wheelers. There's also some pedestrians, surely there's also some two-wheelers here, for example, here. But still, it's more or less directed. For example, always vehicles and pedestrians go into this direction, and here all go in the other direction. In India we have left-hand traffic, so this is here's even a physical marker, which you see is not always obeyed, and there's some chaos. But anyway, this is a nice example of directed, fully two-dimensional traffic. Directed traffic is still more simply to model and simulate than completely undirected traffic. For this we will come in lesson 11, the social force model can also do that. But there's no sensible way to macroscopic model it, and we want to use macroscopic models in this lesson. So there are other examples. This is a famous example. That's the Hajj, that means the pilgrimage in Mecca. Why is this interesting? Because for many years there have been deadly accidents due to stampedes, which are caused by panic. That means just people walked about other people, and it's also like the Love Parade in Duisburg. Nowadays they have, as you see, invested billions to create really freeway lane directed roads for this pilgrimage. There's even traffic signs. For example, here where during the pilgrimage you have to throw stones on the represents of the devil, which are these three columns. And here you see, for example, this is the way to the left column, which represents the devil and which to have been thrown at stones. There's a protocol which stone has to be, which pillar has to be thrown at which time, and so on. And of course there are often millions of people, which is a huge aggregation. That's the other example. That was the Love Parade in Duisburg. There's also sporting events. That's the famous Vasaloppet in Sweden. By the way, I'm one of the participants. I photographed this during the race. And as you see, if you are not very elite cross-country skier, then you are in a huge traffic jam. So there's also a huge jam here. You lose more than 30 minutes while the clock is ticking, because unlike other races, Vasaloppet does not have a wave start regulation. So how to model this? We want first to define the macroscopic 2D quantities before we come to our models later. The density, obviously, because we have now a two-dimensional situation without lanes, so we have just a two-dimensional density, which of course depends also of two coordinates, x in a longitudinal and y in the lateral direction. So the unit is just pedestrians per square meter, or generally objects per square meter. So it's a sort of particle density. Then the normal flow, that means passages per seconds, becomes a flow density. At first sight, this is a strange name. As though you could not decide whether to call it flow or density, and you just call it flow density. But in fact, it's not so strange as it sounds, because it's the flow, that means pedestrians per seconds, per meter of cross section. So it's a sort of if density, one dimension density, is to be understood in the lateral direction, then this is just the flow density, because it just increases with the width of the road, and so it's useful to define an a quantity which is just flow per lateral meter. And that's also the unit, flow pedestrian per seconds, per lateral meter, that means per meter. So the unit is just pedestrian per meter and per seconds. And as in the 1D case with the local velocity and speed, here we have to distinguish between velocity, that's generally the vectorial directed quantity, and the speed. And the speed is just the absolute value of the velocity. Of course, because we have here directed traffic, there's not so much difference, but generally, if we later on also consider undirected traffic, then we really need vectorial quantities. And again, we define the local speed by the hydrodynamic relation, that means flow density divided by the density. And here's also another explanation for the flow density, is just the limit of the flow per lane divided by the lane width for a multi-lane road. If the number of lanes going to infinity, the width of the lanes goes to zero, such that the width remains constant. That means just the sum of the extensive quantities goes over to the integral. And this integral then gives the, it's just the integral over the flow density gives the total flow. That leads us to the one-dimensional quantities. The one-dimensional quantities, of course, we have to aggregate over the other direction. Obviously, in order to compare it with the car traffic, we aggregate over a lateral direction. So that means just the one-dimensional density is just the two-dimensional density integrated over the width of the passage. And if the traffic flow is approximately homogeneous, then we can just say it's the width times the two-dimensional densities with the usual unit pedestrian per meter, as in the vehicular case. The total flow, as I already said, is just the integral of the flow density, and the local speed again is defined such that the hydrodynamic relation is also defined for the local 1D quantities. We now come to the simplest way of modeling traffic flow. It's just a traffic stream model. A traffic stream model is just a fixed relation between two of the three basic macroscopic quantities, local density, flow, and the local speed. Because always the hydrodynamic relation is valid, we have already one, together with the traffic stream model, we would have fixed the traffic flow just as a function of a single quantity, for example, the traffic density, and that. But it's a static relation, so that means, for example, if we have a certain density, then we have a fixed speed, and that also by means of a hydrodynamic relation, this gives a fixed flow. That's, for example, used in the traffic demand modeling in sort of a capacity restraint function, where the input is the flow, the traffic demand, and the output is the time it takes to cover a passage. So this so-called capacity restraint function is a typical example of a traffic stream model. Let's look at the first formulation of a traffic stream model in the history of traffic flow modeling. That's the famous model of Greenshields. So this is the Greenshields 1935, so more than 80 years ago, taking with a camera the passage of the cars. That's an interesting measurement. Although this is a camera which typically takes snapshots, here he just calculates, we use the passage of the different vehicles. That means he used the camera as though it is just a counting detector. And he has not very many data points, but there are some. One is here, and here are some here, and he just, which is of sort of daring and not really correctly, not really right, but he just connected this by a straight line, and that gives the green shield's speed density relation. So this is vehicles per mile. The 200 is the maximum, that means 200 vehicles per mile. That's about 130 vehicles per kilometer is the maximum density. And the maximum speed is miles per hour, 44. That's about 70 kilometer per hour. But interestingly, this is just a straight line. Quantified by this relation, Greenshield's traffic stream model is just the steady state speed is the maximum speed or the desired speed V0 for empty traffic, going linear with the density to zero and reaching zero at the maximum density. So that's the Greenshield's relation. How to get traffic stream models by data? For this, we typically does not refer to the speed density relation, but to the flow density relation. But by virtue of this hydrodynamic relation, flow is speed times density. These are equivalent. Here one would just multiply the left and right hand sides with density. Then we have the flow is equals the here V0 density times this parenthesis. The data are just the scatter plots. It's just the, you know this already, the plotting the flow against the density, but watching out for the systematic bias the density has when using normal accounting data. And if you idealize these scatter plots with some sort of curves or straight lines, then you get traffic stream model, and this special traffic stream model relating the flow with the density is called a fundamental diagram. Now the question is, how would the Greenshield's fundamental diagram look like? As I already said, one has just to multiply the Greenshield's relation for the speed with to the left and right hand side with density. Then on the left hand side we have the flow, and on the right hand side we have just this parabola function. It's an upside down parabola because the quadratic term minus rho squared divided by rho max is negative. Because we have two equations, the hydrodynamic relation and the fundamental diagram or constitutive relation, we can we have two quantities fixed as a function of a third quantity. That means we can plot pairs of two of out of the three quantities and giving different forms of traffic stream models. That's a classical one, the fundamental diagram, which plotting flow against the density. That's like in the original Greenshield's model, it's speed versus the density. Here you also see that the linear assumption is not very valid. If you get more data points, it looks more like a sort of S shape. And finally, you can plot speed versus flow. This representation is rather popular in the US traffic flow community. It has its virtues because, unlike the density, the speed and the flow can be measured directly with stationary detectors, also biased. But essentially, all these three representations are equivalent. You can choose whatever is useful for your problem at hand. A special case, a very popular one, is the triangular fundamental diagram. This has two reasons. First, it often fits real traffic flow data quite well. And second, it is one of the simplest fundamental diagram, and even you could add a third point when making models based on this diagonal fundamental diagram, that means dynamic models, not just traffic stream models, then they can be evaluated very easily and also intuitively. We will come to that in the next lesson in detail. So how does this triangular fundamental diagram look like? It's the flow as a function of density, because it's a fundamental diagram. It has a free branch, V0 rho, that is the left branch, uprising branch, and it has a congested branch. This is this downwards sloping branch, and these are connected in a classical case just by minimum function. There's also a situation with hysteresis in some models and also in some data. Then we have a certain density range where we could have both free and congested flow. And that's as a hysteresis because it depends on the history whether we have a free or congested flow in this density range. But in most time during the lecture, we will just assume no hysteresis, so it's just this normal minimum function. So the left one is the free branch, and the right hand is a congested branch. How to calculate the theoretical capacity and also the density at capacity? At capacity, it's a standard technical term, just meaning that's at the transition between free and congested traffic, and this transition point is just at capacity, as becomes very illustrative by this diagonal fundamental diagram. So how to calculate it? Set this to the free branch and the congested branch flows equal, because that obviously gives the intersection of these two branches, and at least the density coordinate of this intersection, and that's equal to the critical density. So if we do this, we have just the maximum flow is free flow speed times the critical density, and the critical density is just if you set equal this and this, then you have a linear equation for the density, which you can solve for the density, and then you get just this expression. It's also quite intuitive. This critical density is the inverse of the critical distance, and the critical distance is the effective regular length, that means the regular length plus minimum distance, minimum gap, plus the safety distance, which is just the desired speed times the time gap, the safety distance at free traffic at the transition. V0 is equal. V0 is just the free flow speed, and that's obviously the desired speed. The rho max, obviously maximum density, because at this density the flow equals zero. The flow of course also equals for the density is zero, because no vehicles, no flow, because flow is an expensive quantity. And finally, the time gap can be seen best by this expression, because this is just the critical distance, that means the distance corresponding to the critical density. It's just the vehicle length plus the time gap, and times the desired speed. So this t is just the desired time gap, or the minimum safe time gap. How does the fundamental diagram looks like for directed two-dimensional flows? Let's just first look at some data. Here we have a scatter plot of flow density data for some European event, these are the blue dots, and for the Hutch in Mecca. The Hutch in Mecca is somewhat extreme because of the excitement that the people there. So this Blut-Curve is more representative. And also, that gives the typical parameters. That means a maximum density of about 5 pedestrians per square meter. That's quite densely packed, because that means every pedestrian has a space less than 50 times 50 centimeters squared left. And also, we have a maximum flow density of somewhat above 1 pedestrian per meter and per seconds. And that's a typical household number for directed two-dimensional pedestrian streams. How to model this? Unlike the vehicular case, for pedestrians, the green shields speed density relation and the green shields fundamental diagram, that means the inverse upside down parabola one, is a good approximation. As can be seen here, it looks like a parabola, not really. It's a little bit shifted to the left, but it's not as bad as the approximation would be for the vehicular flow. So let's just start with the simplest possible, just the fundamental diagram parabola one. Interesting now is how to get from 2D to effective 1D. Here, of course, we need some assumptions. For example, we can assume that the pedestrians form a moving square grid. Every pedestrian at the same speed, so idealized homogeneous pedestrian traffic. Then the longitudinal distance is equal to the lateral distance. That means the both distances are equal to 1 over square root of the density. Remember, the density is pedestrians per square meter, so this delta V would be just where you only have a unit meter. And that would correspond to several not interacting single files in parallel with delta V. And then we can just reformulate density, one-dimensional density is just square root of a two-dimensional density, because it's a square grid. That means the typical lateral distance is equal to the typical longitudinal distance. One-dimensional flow is, by the definition, the flow is just the flow density times the width. And if we say it's just the width of one single file, that means then we can have flow divided by square root of the density, or flow divided by the 1D density. And if we insert all this into the fundamental diagram, then we obtain, so inserting this here, and then inserting for in this relation again the one-dimensional quantities, then we get this relation for the effective 1D fundamental diagram emerging from the 2D parabola fundamental diagram. And it looks similar, but this is symmetric, so this is the 2D case, and this is asymmetric. So when going from 2D to 1D, there's even some transformation in the shape. So that was also a difference, symmetric versus asymmetric. Then maybe some specific question. We have a 30 meter wide approach corridor. That is, for example, the case in the Love Parade in Duisburg, at the position where the accident, the stampede happens. Unidirectional pedestrian flow and the green shields fundamental diagram. Desired speed 1.2 meter per second, maximum density 5 pedestrians per square meter. It's similar. It's, for example, such as this fundamental diagram, this one, similar to that one. So then we have maximum flow density, that means the specific capacity is just taking the derivative and setting it to zero of J from rho. Then we have this idle speed when maximum density divided by 4, and that's just 1.5 pedestrians per meter per second, and that corresponds to a left diagram. That means if we have 30 meter width, then we have 1.5 times 30 pedestrian per second, that means 45 pedestrian per second. And if we multiply this with 3,600, then we have 162,000 pedestrians per hour, or approximately 160,000 pedestrians per hour. So if the event would accommodate 1 million of participants, then the approach, the access alone, would take 1 million divided by 160,000. That's about 6 hours. And things get worse if somebody wants to leave the event, because two-directional traffic typically has less capacity than one unidirectional traffic. Finally, there's a special fundamental diagram which is often used for pedestrian traffic. And in fact, this fundamental diagram, which is a little bit left, is similar to this empirical one, this blue curve here. This concludes the first part of lecture 5 of traffic dynamics and a simulation. In the second part, we will learn about the two principles for setting up any macroscopic traffic flow model. Many thanks.